Welcome to Cube and Chaos. Spend some time with us, enjoying old cards and new, whether they are weak or powerful.
Hello everybody, and welcome to another episode of Cube and Chaos. And the good thing is, it's not just Max and I this time, but we have another guest. It's Juan.
Hello guys. Nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming. We're glad to talk to you. Excited to talk about the Chaos formats we've had recently and also the Supreme Vintage format. Not sure if we'll get to the Arena Cube, but yeah, that's something I'd like to discuss as well.
Sounds good.
Right now, the Arena Cube as best of one is still available, and I think it's nice. So if you have an Arena account, it's not too expensive to play this. I think it's a losing game, but not by all too much. The buy-in is relatively cheap, so just go ahead and try that out. And also, the Supreme Vintage is still available. But first, let's talk a bit with Juan, who's online known as SE8 or Set Twitch on Twitch, about his way into Magic. How long have you been playing?
Well, really, I started Magic a long, long time ago. When I first went to an LGS, I think it was Revised that was around. And Fallen Empires was the expansion of the time. And yeah, I read an article in the newspaper and I told my friend, we have to try this. And yeah, been hooked ever since. Not really. I quit Magic for 10 years, I think.
Oh, all right.
And then, yeah, it was around Chronicles, I think. And then I sold out. When I came back, I read about Limited. And that sounded spicy. Limited didn't exist back in the time.
Yeah.
And ever since, I've only drafted. I've done some seals for tourneys, but I haven't gone back into Constructed. I returned around M13, I think it was. Scars of Mirrodin was out. Went to the shop, and yeah, I found it amazing, man. And
so, like around 2010, roughly?
Roughly, I think. That's about right, yeah.
That's awesome.
And I did go to some GPs back in the day. I remember it was when Kirdape Lightning Bolt was the meta, and I took a Millstone deck with Field of Dreams, Wrath of God, and yeah, man, that was the times. So yeah, I've never been very competitive in Magic, honestly, but now I grind Limited, so eventually, yeah.
Not very tournament competitive, maybe, but it's been what? The past two or three Chaos formats that I've seen you on the leaderboard, so.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. I mean, I've had time to play. Also, I play a lot with Jasper, with the Spy, and we Skype and we're friends, and we actually qualified for a couple of MOX qualifiers. So I think 2019, my name showed up in the MTGO page, the leaderboard. I think I had like 12 points or something like that. Which was amazing. I mean, I didn't look for that, but hey.
Yeah, sweet.
Happy with that there.
Yeah, I know it's quite possible to queue into you, especially if you play in the European afternoon times, roughly, on the weekend, on my weekend. It happens from time to time that I queue into you, and let me tell you, I have not had good times.
we played recently a couple of times, yeah. Hey, it's always fun to play again.
Oh, yeah, lovely.
Acquaintances. But... And also, that's one of the reasons I play MTGO now, because Jasper, the Spy,
yeah,
he always tells me the anecdote. He became attracted to me because he saw me playing a self-mill deck. And yeah, I was a little bit of a maniac, and that clicked with him. So yeah, we started playing together, and he introduced me to MTGO. He grinded there, and I wasn't very fond of paying for playing Magic, honestly. And it did cost me around a year to go infinite in just playing Limited.
Right.
So.
Yep. Yeah. Not an easy task to accomplish to go infinite playing Limited only.
I remember exactly the day when I stopped paying for playing MTGO, and that was when someone passed me a foil mythic in Guilds of Ravnica or Ravnica Allegiance, and it was like 88 ticks at the time. and that exact day was when I had to stop putting money in the platform.
That's awesome. It was actually around Guilds of Ravnica that I started going infinite too. Like, I already had a pretty decent win percentage in, like, Friendly Sealed, but that was, I think, Guilds of Ravnica, where it was like, okay, well, I guess I won't be putting any money onto Magic Online for the foreseeable future. And that's such a great feeling.
Oof, it's such a relief, man. I mean, I struggled. And I had to put a ban on myself, right? When I wanted, I had to stop playing for the day.
Are you saying that just to keep yourself from playing too much in one day? Or do you mean it affects you mentally?
It was both, because I also think Magic is a pretty addictive game, right? And yes. and I think that I don't have Arena, but from what I read, from what I hear from people, just jamming drafts one after the other, it's kind of you tend to go there, right? It's like a psychological thing. It has you hooked. That's actually an issue. I think it's underrepresented in the discussion in Magic, and it's addiction to the game, right? But we could say that about a lot of games. And
it's games in general that doesn't make it better for this specific one, right? It's still a problem.
Yeah, it is. So for me, it was like a monetary. It was also like a discipline thing I apply to myself. If you're playing MTGO and you're paying for each draft, you can pay for one draft a day, right? Yeah, and that was. I mean, if I took one and then I opened something, then maybe I put in a couple more ticks. I bought a couple ticks, whatever. But whenever I X2'd, I had to move on, find another activity for the day. So that gave me some discipline because, yeah, I'm a bit of a maniac playing, and I'm a bit of a Johnny too.
So that is probably then also reflected in your spellbook, right?
Oh, most certainly. Yeah, I have an interesting one to show you.
Do you want to introduce us to the concept of the spellbook again, Finite, for the people tuning in for the first time?
Absolutely, yeah. So this is an idea that I saw originally from Jim Davis, but I'm not sure if he is the first source of it. So there could be someone else. But the idea is really you find a small number of cards that really kind of exemplify who you are. They kind of totalize your identity as a Magic player. And usually that is associated with some number of good memories you've had with those cards. Sometimes it's with cards that other people underrate. Could just be a pet card that you never even played with, but you liked how it looked.
I wanted to start with Happily Ever After. Happily Ever After is an Eldraine rare. It's a 2 and a white encampment that when it enters the battlefield, each player gains 5 life and draws a card. And then it has a lot of text, and the last line says, "You win the game." So obviously the card spoke to me. But even I saw it as a complete meme, right? I mean, the requisites to get there are impossible. Once I drafted the card and I managed to, I too won the league, but I did get a win with it. I opened it in my pack actually, so I knew it was there. I knew nobody was going to take it, and I drafted other things. I mean, I didn't take it, but I willed it and I said, yeah, sure, bring it. And in the next pack, I opened an Oko. It was the only Oko I opened in Eldraine, and I must have played 100, 200 drafts in the format. So I had only Boros cards, but I said, man, it's my only Oko. I want to play it. So in the end, I ended in a 5-color pile, I got there. And actually, I uploaded the screenshot to Reddit, and I think it was like one of the most voted, and the title was, "Guys, we fucking got there." And I think it was one of the most voted posts in the LRcast subreddit, actually. I 2-1 that league even with that deck. So yeah, most of on the back of Oko. I mean, I remember a game where I landed Oko and the opponent conceded. But yeah.
Understandably.
Yeah. And then it was amazing. What can I say? I mean, it's a fond memory of mine. This card obviously is not the centerpiece of the deck, but I also playtest for Limited with Juan José Rodríguez López. He's a Spanish pro. He's played he's top 8ed a couple of PTs. He played the last Mythic Championship, and he tells me I love fantasy too much. But it's also I also tell him, yeah, but the thing is, fantasy takes you to places where you don't get normally in Magic. It doesn't always come together, but sometimes you can go over the top with it. My number two is Psychic Spiral. Psychic Spiral is 4 and a blue for a sorcery. It says, shuffle all cards from your graveyard into your library, and then target player mills that many cards. So that's where the juice is at. The story with this card for me is, I was telling you earlier, Jasper the Spy, he was looking at that game of mine. And in that game, I was putting chronic floodings on my lands, trying to mill my whole deck. and the guy said, yeah, this guy's a total maniac. And we became friends. I have a soft spot for Mio, and yeah, this card has it all for me. I first picked it in Chaos Draft recently. This was not this last one, probably the other one, the one before that. And I wanted to recreate something with it. And I found Stinkweed Imps, you know, the Dredge 5. So yeah, I just built a super control deck.
Ooh, nice.
Eventually I Psychic Spiral for the win with like 2 cards in my library. I mean, it's a one shot win the game card. So yeah,
it feels so good because you know that your opponent's thinking like, oh, I got this. There's no way I can lose now. There are 2 cards.
Absolutely, man. I love doing this kind of junk personally. I love that kind of games and I love that kind of magic where you have different angle. I think card number 3 kind of, wants to put a counterbalance to all this. And my third card would be Raging Goblin.
Really?
Raging Goblin is a 1-mana, a 1/1 haste for a red.
I think you're obligated to read the flavor text as well.
He raged at the world, at his family, at his life, but mostly he just raged.
Thank you.
Yeah. After all these years, it's still
so
nice.
Yeah, after talking about these 2 previous cards, I also wanted to bring this up to light because I also love a compact aggro deck. You know, I love playing aggro too. I think I have a wide range, right? I mean, I can go from janky combo to 15 land mono red, and this is exactly what happened the first time we played a Chaos on MTGO with Jasper. That was only 2 or 3 years ago, right? We didn't have Chaos Draft before.
It's not that long.
And our first deck was the first deck I've ever built with 15 lands. And it was a mono red. And yeah, this card was a house. What can I say? It's all you want. And I love aggro decks because like you have to play it super tight. Every point matters. Sometimes you just need 1 more attacker than they have blockers. Sometimes I've jumped attack just to get in 2 damages and lose my board because I know my outs in my deck.
Yep.
And what opponent might land that I can't beat. So I just need to get these 2 points in here because it's only going downhill from this point onwards.
Yep.
Right? So this issue brings me to card number 4, which would be, I think, a more reasonable magic card, which is Wild Mongrel.
That's a very strong one compared to the last ones.
Yeah, I think it's the best card in my Jasper called this in my list the 15th picks. And yeah, Wild Mongrel is a very strong magic card. And yeah, I wanted to bring it because I had a game in Chaos Draft where I had it in my deck. This was game 3 of our match. And my opponent had a Landfall Baloth. It's a rare from some Zendikar. The one that makes 4/4s.
Crackshot and I just recorded a draft of Chaos Masters. And that was our pack 1 pick 1. And that video we'll have linked. But yeah, if you haven't seen that one, make sure to check it out. It's a sweet one. Anyway, continue one.
I have, and it reminded me of this anecdote, and I think it's telling. And yeah, well, my opponent just demolished me game 1 with that, and I think I somehow won game 2. And then in game 3, I just had my Wild Mongrel there. I think it was my turn to play, and my opponent like ramped into the Baloth. And I was like, okay, this card's unbeatable. I don't have a kill spell for it. Maybe I had an arrest or something, but I don't have. But I drew my Hand the Week.
Wow.
Before, I mean, he just landed it, right? And I drew my Hand the Week. And I thought, like, man, I can't. But really, I said, well, what I can't is beat this card anywhere else. So I ditched 4 cards to the Mongrel, maybe the 6/6. And cast Hand the Week. So I traded every resource I had, every resource literally, to just kill that. And they moved on to win that match.
Well, if you pitched four and played Hunt the Week, then you kept the Mongrel, right?
Yeah, and smacked them for seven.
Yeah.
It's still...
But it was left Hellbent, yeah, right? Yeah. With a 3-3.
Of course.
And yeah, but actually it was the, I think it was the only line that could give me that win. So I know the heuristic is, actually I wanted to mention that the heuristic in Magic is, you know, 2-for-1 yourself, but my heuristic is you have to do what you have to do.
Yeah. If you don't have other outs, then, but the important question is, did the Wild Mongrel have every single color?
Every color. I went through all of them.
Perfect.
It got the job done. So, yeah, amazing memory for me too. So, next card would be Fruit of the First Tree. And I know you guys are thinking, yeah, what is that card? Well, this was an uncommon in Fate Reforged. And it's an aura that costs 3 and a green. And it says, Encant Creature. When Encanted Creature dies, you gain X life and draw X cards, where X is its toughness. Okay? So, unplayable garbage. But only sometimes your drafts go so wrong that you need to find the power somewhere. So this is a card that, while is not at all good, it might draw you 5 cards and gain you 5 life. And that's what happened. We had a train wreck of a draft with Jasper. It was in Fate Reforged. And yeah, we had a couple 4-5s, 5-5s, I don't know. And also you can encant an opponent's creature that you're gonna kill.
Oh, right, yeah.
And we took it, and we said, well, our draft is an F, so let's give it a shot. And it actually worked for us. I don't remember exactly the details of the draft, but yeah, we always talk about it because I like trying to be creative in my drafts. And honestly, I've lost to so many things, and I've won with so many things that every card in, that's actually what I like about Chaos Draft, right? Chaos Draft is amazing because you have access to the whole pool of Magic cards. Not the whole pool, but let's say a good representation. And then all those cards play together since day one. That's good design from Magic, yeah, right? That's the beauty of Limited and of Chaos Draft, that you can do all kinds of blends that have never been put together before and try to... I like the creativity aspect of this.
Yeah, Chaos Draft brings out cards from sets that were unplayable in these environments because they were just not powerful enough. But with all these old sets in between, from time to time, cards can show up and really matter.
So I think my next card, then, to keep on with the trend, would be Allure of the Unknown. This is a pretty recent card, and this is Tethos Beyond Death, and it's a rare. And it's 3 black-red for a sorcery. You reveal the top 6 cards of your library. Your opponent puts one of them in play, and you draw the rest. So, yeah, when this got spoiled, obviously, it was garbage, right?
Yeah.
It's obvious. It's this card's not great. However, there's a couple decks which I think it fits. There's a couple of nice synergies with it. One of them is, I mean, obviously the card is Rakdos, so you're talking mostly about those kinds of decks. And a low curve aggro Rakdos deck, which only has like removal and 3-1s, you know, and in particular, 3-1s that come back from your grave. What's the mechanic from Theros?
Escape.
Yeah, Escape.
Okay. Yeah.
Particularly cards with Escape. If this is your curve topper, what's your opponent gonna get? Can kill one of your creatures? You can get a small 3-1, and then you get 5 cards. It's a 5-4-2, yeah, let's say. So yeah, it's a very powerful card. You just have to try to build a deck where it fits.
Specifically in the Rakdos aggro shell you were talking about, that just sounds like good deck building to me. Like, that sounds like the kind of thing that I think most people would miss.
I do love the drafting part of that, and at the deck building, I think it's super, super interesting. And you can get a lot of edges there.
So that makes me wonder, have you ever built a cube yourself?
I have not. Jasper has, yeah. And he has some very good ones. And I've tuned his cubes, but I haven't really got, because I have no collection, really, of physical cards. Yeah. I wouldn't say I'm very much into cube construction.
Yeah, I feel like if you got into it at some point, I think you could have a lot of fun with it. It sounds like something you would enjoy.
Yeah, I would love to give it a shot. So I have one more card.
Please.
It's Abandoned Sarcophagus.
I think I know that.
Abandoned Sarcophagus. All the junk rares. It's this one was from Hour of Devastation, and it was the 3-mana artifact that let you cast the cycling cards from your graveyard. You may cast spells that have cycling ability from your graveyard, but if a card that has a cycling ability would be put into your graveyard from anywhere and it wasn't cycled, exile it instead.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So yeah, that's a junk rare, if there ever was one. However, in Hour of Devastation, there was a lot of cycling. So yeah, I mean, it's the dream if you can just pick that early or actually hope to wheel it and just build the deck with all the cyclers. It's amazing. You have to try to give fantasy some room, you know, in your games and in your approach to magic. And I think that's where the magic happens for me.
Yeah.
I hate forcing in drafts. That's one of the things I don't like about magic is when you just stick into your first picks and just taking the best card in your color or colors.
Yeah.
I think I need some very, very big reason to be drafting like that.
So we can have that as a nice transition to talking a little bit about Supreme Chaos, because this type of draft, we've talked about it a bunch, is like not real drafting. So we have talked about it a lot, but I want to hear how you feel about it. And then in that context, how you then approach the Supreme Chaos.
I kind of agree with that. It's definitely not real drafting. And again, the spy hasn't played this at all. I've played this mostly on myself because we do draft out together mostly always. So we're like a team we're accomplices in crime. And this one I've played mostly on my own.
Yeah.
And yeah, the format has a lot of particularities, right? One of them is your card pool is so much smaller that you can only afford that many mispicks. And also that leads for people to stick into their first rares, to their first picks, and trying to build a deck with those. And that, I think, takes away from the format. I think the format defaulted to 5-color in the end, because you just picked the fixing very highly and tried to fit in your more powerful stuff. However, some of my best decks in the format have been streamlined. I particularly remember an Izzet deck that was Izzet spells, basically. Super aggro, super tempo. It was really, really good. And it's a format where you actually need very good, you kind of need good decks to get there because people are playing very powerful stuff. In the end, you see 18 rares. If you get rewarded, and somehow your first colors are open, you can end up with really busted decks in the format.
Yeah, but it's just you are really relying on opening them. And I think that's why so many people defaulted to 5-color. If you open yourself up early with fixing picks, then you know that you will not miss some great rares later on.
And that's also precisely why an Izzet tempo deck or just a Boros aggro deck can be very good in the format.
Yes.
Because I don't care about the power of your cards, because I'm going to try to put you dead before you can deploy them.
Yes, but that much fewer people have done. And I approached it like this 5-color approach first, because it's just logic to do that. But I didn't enjoy it very much. Like it didn't feel like chaos draft to me.
Yeah, in a sense, I agree. And also notice how my spellbook is all just weird stuff. But then I have a fond memory of a deck that's super streamlined in Supreme Chaos, because I think that was the challenge here, right? The challenge was building something. It's kind of metaing in a sense, right?
Yes.
You know, the meta is slow and battle cruiser magic and the different angle here is trying to be aggro.
It's like the story of my career in the alternative play calendar. Like if you go back to Cons Cube, where I was like the trophy leader for a few days, and then I was like, well, you know, I've gotten my 8 or 9 trophies, I guess I'm done playing aggro because I'm bored of it. And then I would do like the same thing in like the Grixis Cube. Everyone else is playing blue and black, And I'm sitting there with mono red saying, okay, kill you turn four. Like, it's just, I don't know. Yeah. That's something I enjoy. And I think from what I know here, it wasn't that clear cut because the formats that I was just describing were cubes. And it felt like to win, it was the same thing every time. It was like the same, you know, Hellrider, like curving up through that card to do it. Whereas like in this environment, it seemed like, you know, it wasn't just mono red aggro. It was like, is that tempo? It was, you know, maybe your black blue control deck kind of thing even, or Boros aggro, but just like, there were different ways to be two colors without, you know, playing the same deck every time.
Yeah. So definitely. I abandoned this five color, like race to the bottom, to the maximum controlling card deck, because I just didn't enjoy it, and I also felt like I'm not playing it well. Like when I'm not really enjoying doing something, then I'm also starting to play worse and worse. So I decided to switch it up and try to draft two color relatively aggressive decks, and that worked out like amazingly for me. I don't know, I think I got 2-7 trophies in the end, but six of them were in a streak, and that felt quite good.
It does tend to feel quite good.
Yeah, and I just decided that I wanted to play two color decks that just affected the board relatively early. And I stayed open for finding these two colors during like about a third of the packs, so six packs. And then I just locked myself in and drafted the cards to fill out the curve. And that sometimes felt really bad, like taking some random 3-2 for 3 mana over like some great, amazing bomb. But then in the end, I noticed that to me, it also felt so good to beat some of those 5 color decks that had all these bombs later with this stupid 3-2.
So this, I think, we can connect it back to Raging Goblin. And what I was trying to say there is also in this kind of, when you're drafting super low curve, for example, your threes and fours become so much more relevant. Like, for example, Hungering Flames, I think, was the card. Like, deal 3 to a creature and 2 to the opponent or something like that. Or the other day I had Searing Blood in my Issa deck. So drafting like the super fast stuff makes those cards exponentially better. I mean, when you're untapping on turn 4, and you have the board presence, you tell them 6-8 damage, and suddenly you can play a 3-4 mana spell that's super relevant. That spell is infinitely better in that deck than in any other deck. It's the same card, but it's just a completely different impact that it has on the game. And I think your deck building should aim towards that. That, I mean, that's what I think one of the key things in aggro.
And another thing that these decks did, what I noticed just playing later, not like thinking it out ahead of time, but then I noticed that in these decks, a lot of the equipment that is in the original Mirrodin block just is, it's just amazing in normal Chaos Draft, and it's great in those decks, but these cards are not really there for these 5 color piles. They just can't make use of a Skull Clamp that well, unless they found some random other combo. I mean, it's still great in their deck, but it's nowhere comparable to like an aggressive deck that plays some shitters every turn.
Yeah, and Skullclamp is like the epitome, right, of equipment. You have GT, you have Skullclamp. But even the cycle, like the Neurok Stealth Suit, I think it's named, the ones that equip at instant.
Yeah.
Right? Those ones, sometimes, I mean, it's counterintuitive, but those cards might have a lot of more impact in your deck than the rare in the pack. I am a sucker for rares, personally. So I think when you're consciously doing the decision of taking those cards early over much better cards, you are already cementing something towards winning, you know, because you're making that the conscious effort to avoid the temptation to pick the broken thing, try to get the maximum out of this much worse card. And I think that's how I like to approach drafting too. And playing, of course.
Speaking of Skullclamp, I was pretty busy, unfortunately, during the Supreme Chaos season, but Crackshot wasn't. So I got to check out his stream multiple times during this, which was really a treat. And, you know, not only just checking out the stream of a really nice good player, but a really nice good player who got what you said, 6 trophies in a row. So really someone who's just mastering the format. And so, yeah, if you like to watch people on Twitch, make sure to give him a follow. I don't know how often he'll be streaming in the future, but it was great fun hanging out there.
Yeah, from time to time.
I've been there too, definitely. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but before I got to that streak, I was beaten up very badly by Juan. In a very funny match. It was like on a Saturday morning for me, and I played a deck I drafted the night before, and queued up, played against, or was paired against you, and were chatting a bit, and then it was pretty funny, like, because I had one of the 4 color or something controlling decks, and you said to me, "Oh, I think my deck's not very good, and my first draw wasn't great, and I don't know." But what was the name of this card that I played into 3 times in a row? Was it 4 turns in a row? I don't know.
Oh, yeah, it was a protection spell with clash, right?
Yes, one and a white.
Yeah, I don't know the card. I really, it was literally the first time in my life I saw that card. But
yeah, it's for 1 and a white, an instant, and it gives a creature or your creature protection from a color of your choice until the end of turn.
Looks like it's called Redeem the Lost.
Yes. And then you clash. If you win the clash, you get the card back in your hand.
I mean, it seemed good in the meta, right? It's just bombs and removal. So
yes. So the thing is, I think the first time you played it was in the creature combat, and you won the clash. And I, like, Magic Online reveals the cards that are clashed, and I looked at the card and kept it open to remember that you have that, and then I played some other turn, and I did another block maybe, and you played the card again, and I thought, like, oh shit, Magic Online didn't reveal that the card got back to your hand, but obviously because you won the clash, it was back in your hand. I just completely forgot about it, and that felt really bad. I made a comment in chat, and then in my next turn, I top decked the removal spell, snapped it off on your creature, and you obviously had it again.
The 5 mana removal spell. Yeah. I remember precisely.
Wow.
That card was good, but also the seal. The +3/+3 seal was really nice, man. I mean, I also had, it was just a green something, green white deck. Nothing particularly good. Okay. But the seal, that's a big, that giant growth. But it's on the battlefield. So just the threat of activation makes everything so awkward, man.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't shoot a damage removal spell when I have that out. You can't engage in combat when I have that out. It just makes everything awkward. And then you have the protection spell. So yeah, I think that's the combination of 2 cards was what matters most.
The protection spell reminds me a lot of Prismatic Strands. And it sounds like both with that card and the protection spell and the Seal of Strength, those are kind of cards you just have to play into. Like, you don't really have another choice.
Yeah. And that's amazing. That's the strength of those cards.
But what I wanted to say again, I was not quite done with the story, because you only won those clashes so often because you really built your deck very nicely. And you had quite a bit of scrying together with the clash card to make sure that you win the clashes. And that is just great deck building. It was just very cool.
Thank you. It's always some luck involved there. Probably won the first one out of luck.
Yes, but... But then after you really had a nice cry and then Clash Engine there, and that was really cool. Like, seeing these things, that did make it feel like Chaos Draft.
Oh man. I don't love losing, but I'm not that into winning that I cannot appreciate when someone does cool stuff. It's happened to me lately in these vintage cube Supremes mostly. Sometimes you're just sitting there watching them go off, and they're like, well, whatever, man. Do your thing. Kudos to you. And I'm glad I shared this with you guys, because I actually met Finit playing Chaos.
That's a generous way of saying you crushed me with a 5-color deck.
when it still wasn't the default, that was just normal Chaos. Yeah, we just had a lot of bombs, that one.
You had the rare Phoenix that you can cast. It's like 3 and a red for a 2/2 flyer, but then if it ends up in the graveyard, you can cast it for Wooburg, and it's like a 4/4 flyer or something, just like a completely unbeatable card for me.
And also we had another guy in that cycle, the black one.
Yeah, Flesh
Bomber. It's a black 2/2. Yeah, that kills something then. Yeah, that was sweet, man. I would play Chaos all year. And I gotta admit, the first times I played it, it was in Cockatrice, and I thought the format was a joke, a complete joke. I said, well, what is this, man? This is unworkable. But it grew on me so much, and yeah, it's the only format I played, honestly. I wish it was evergreen on MTGO.
Yeah, I wish so too.
All right. So I thought one good thing to wrap up the discussion of the Supreme Chaos format and transition to the Masters Chaos format was the set selection. So I, from the beginning of Chaos Draft on Magic Online, have been really interested in the sets that are on there. This time it looks like they chose to exclude core sets and also some of the older blocks. Also, they didn't tell us this, so I could be wrong about some of these things.
Yeah.
But I always would like to know the changes. So, Wizards, if you're listening to this, please tell me, because it's more work for me to try to infer. But I think Mirage block was gone. I think Tempest block was gone. I think Urza block was the oldest one on there. And I think Masks block was probably missing too. Anyway.
Didn't see it, yeah.
No Kamigawa, which is always a trick.
The thing is, with Kamigawa, I know it's not making the format better, but I still always enjoy seeing Kamigawa packs because it is really the set that I started playing with. Like, not like competitively, but it was like the boosters we first bought were, well, it was Fifth Dawn and then a lot of Kamigawa boosters. So, yeah, for me it's a little bit sad when it's not there. Yeah.
Nostalgia is a factor.
Yeah, exactly.
Magic. Yeah, definitely.
I have similar feelings. Like, I think the old sets are part of what makes Chaos Draft great. So whenever they do like a Pioneer kind of Chaos thing, I'm always really disappointed that I don't get to play with the old cards. I don't get to do any crazy mind games with onboard tricks. I actually really liked how this format was constructed in terms of the sets that were in it. Most importantly, I think one of the recent Chaos formats had Modern Horizons in it. Like, everything else was pretty fair, and then all of a sudden it was Modern Horizons. And I think you can really omit like a number of older sets without changing too much. It's really when you include a set that's more powerful than everything else that it starts messing things up.
I think I tend to agree, yeah. Modern Horizons should be counted as a master set, and if it's not all master sets, then there shouldn't be just one of them.
Yeah, and the Masters one, I think, could have used Modern Horizons and could have also used the Masters editions, man. That would have given a lot of coolness to the format.
I think that would have been really polarizing, because those packs were like, sometimes you get a Soul Ring or a Library of Alexandria, but most of the time it's like, do I want this 7-mana 4/5? Like,
no, but you also had like Copper Tablet, you had Orcish Lumberjack. I mean, you had powerful cards. Also the bombs, and also to add a bit of diversity, right? That not everything. I have to admit, I expect the format to be much more busted than it was.
Yeah.
It didn't turn up being. It did feel like chaos in the end. It did feel a strange chaos, but chaos. Yeah.
I felt like, and we I think we agree on that, Max. I think it felt a bit like a cube that is not so focused.
Right.
Because there were like synergies across the sets, and it was much more powerful than normal Chaos Draft, but didn't feel like a normal limited set, for sure.
So my guess is what makes a master set technically a master set, in addition to just having the word Masters like in the name. Like, the reason Modern Horizons isn't there is because there were cards like newly printed in Modern Horizons that were not in the rest of the master sets. There are no new cards, right? But I agree. Like, I think that even though it's technically breaking a rule, including that would have greatly improved the format, because for me, one of the biggest problems was you just saw the same sets over and over. And like, I think that the, you know, Masters Edition ones, which I would assume they don't count as master sets. I don't really know how that works. I think, like I said, it would be really divisive in terms of whether people enjoyed it or not with those in there. But to me, it's less about what the actual sets are and more about just increasing the number that are in there. Because with only, I think it was only 9 sets. I mean, you're seeing the same set like nearly three times on average, and some of the time would be like right in a row, and it would just feel like, you know, how is it chaos if you're just drafting the same set anyway?
I think the idea is cool, but it came out a bit narrow in the end. I mean, I like the idea of a powerful chaos draft, but it did have its drawbacks in the end.
Crankshot set, I really like it as a cube, sort of in that mindset. I like it as this like very powerful set in terms of commons and uncommons. And then the rares make a little less sense in terms of the drafting environment, because I mean that's how they have to sell packs, right? So instead of catering it toward, you know, some 1 week Magic Online event, it's catered toward like exciting and expensive reprints that will get people to buy the set. So I feel like just creating, if someone created like a cube with most of the same cards, but mostly different rares, I think that probably would have been more successful for me.
I completely agree with what you're saying. And there was a lot of unplayable cards that were only constructed cards, really. There's the black thing that makes zombies when it's in your graveyard, but whenever a creature goes to the graveyard, you actually...
Bridge from Below. Oh, I was so tempted to playing that in one of my decks, but then I didn't because I knew it was not a good idea. But because it was a really strong deck. It was the first deck I drafted. And yeah, I picked up some discard outlets in between, and I had a lot of sacrifice outlets. And I had, I don't know, Blood Artist or something.
Should have gone for that.
Of similar fashion, like working that way. And I really thought it would be so cool to like have a board, discard Bridge from Below, sack my board twice to burn them for, I don't know, 10 or something. But then I stopped myself from doing that. And, I didn't really regret it, but I was tempted.
What this format allowed was the Storm thing.
Yeah,
remember that was a cool twist to, because there was the Storm cards. And yeah, I mean, there weren't so much of the enablers, but hey, the Storm cards were there, so that was also.
Apparently, it was enough.
No, it was like a how do you say, like a steep. It was like a steep, right? You saw an early Storm card and said, "Well, here we go. Could try it."
Yeah. So that's actually something I was going to ask you about, because I know that you got Storm to work on at least one occasion, but I also know that Beers SC, who's in our Discord and was one of the trophy leaders for this format, I believe trophied with Storm multiple times, which to me is just like blowing.
Yeah, insanity, man. I personally, mine was with Brain Freeze, and Jasper gave me the idea. He said, "We're gonna have to do a Storm to it," and I said, "Like, sure, man." And yeah, I was alone that day, but I saw the early freeze, and I said, "Well, the egg ended atrocious, and it didn't have the key cards, because there's a couple of key cards that that allowed you to a lot of spells. It was basically the Karu lands with discard that draw two, discard two, and tap lands.
Frantic,
and that was a really really good engine for that. But I had to do it a bit more on my own. But I did have a bubble and a repeal. So I had the fairies that untap to lands. So I did have some tools. I did manage to get to seven spells twice and brain freeze for lethal. It wasn't enough in finals, sadly.
Well,
but yeah, doing it with tendrils. I also saw the beers things, and that was ridiculous. I mean, he tendrils for 12, I think.
Yeah,
I really didn't think that was possible. I
didn't even think a brain freeze for seven or whatever it was possible. So
I definitely found out on the way, and I really needed everything to tie seven spells together in limited. I mean, you don't have the ramp, the acceleration, you don't have the card draw, you don't have the. Actually, my deck was a little blue green beatdown deck in the end, that happened to have a Storm win. So yeah, I mean, it was fun. It was fun, and yeah, milled out an opponent or two. So yeah, I mean, Storm is great. I mean, there gets a time when you've been playing enough, then all you want to do is Storm, because it has everything, right? It's the different angle. It's the, I know it's a bit horrible to play on the other side of the table against Storm, because it feels a little bit onanistic, right? You're just doing all these things on your own with no interaction, no anything. Yeah. But in Chaos, it was really good because the deck was really something else. It wasn't a dedicated Storm deck.
Is Storm a big thing in the Supreme Vintage Cube draft that's currently online?
From my experience, a bit less than I expected. I always try to fit in a brain freeze when I see it, because sometimes who's doing 10 spells a turn is your opponent.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
So suddenly you see the card draw and then you freeze them. But I've tried it myself. I found Emrakul's mostly on the other side. So that wasn't great. I mean, I don't think you should build a Storm deck with brain freeze in Supreme Vintage Cube. Maybe with Tendrils. Tendrils also works very nicely with the the 3/3 black artifact.
Oh, Bolas.
That you can place Bolas Citadel. Yeah, that works very nicely with that.
I've seen a game of Magic trivia. Here.
Sorry, I'm super bad with card names. And as you might have noticed, but I was seeing Reed Duke the other day play Storm on the Vintage Supreme, and yeah, I mean. Storm is fantastic. Actually, I think the best decks are Storm decks.
Yeah.
I think it's the one deck that can beat everything.
Okay, so to talk about this format a little. So this is our first like Supreme Cube format. All the other Supreme drafts we've had have been what? They've been Ravnica, they've been Modern Horizons, and yeah, of course, the Chaos format that we just had. And so because we haven't seen a format with the cube yet, we didn't know whether packs were going to repeat. And that wasn't announced, as far as I could see, anywhere in the Magic Online articles. And so I was expecting that packs wouldn't repeat. I thought it would be a little bit too crazy if they could, and I was wrong. they did repeat, so yeah, you could get repeat pieces of power, and by you could, I mean everyone was trying to. That was like, that's sort of the name of the game. And yeah, and blue, which is normally considered by a lot of people the best color, is now uncontested, meaning everybody can draft blue. This is like the kind of thing that a few episodes ago, Jacob and I were talking about with the spider spawning deck there was an Innistrad Supreme as well. That back then, we thought that, or at least I thought that it was just going to be one Innistrad set as opposed to the Innistrad sets Mike Savison restored. People were very, very vocal about this. Normally, the Magic community has a lot of complaints, but normally those don't apply to the alternative play formats, not that much. But this time, everywhere I looked, people were complaining. People were saying things like, I don't want to try this format. This format's degenerate. There's no replayability. It's like, why did they do this? Give us regular Vintage Cube, please. And yeah, this is all over Twitter, Twitch, even on Discord a little bit. Just almost no one was really excited for this format. So yeah, my experience in this format was very limited because I just did one draft, and yeah, I guess you'll have to excuse the pun of limited. But the point was, I tried to do the thing everyone else was doing. I went into the draft trying to take pieces of power left and right. And Snogglesworth, who's also in this Discord, joined me for this draft. And we only got one Mox Emerald throughout the whole draft. That was our only piece of power. And we tried to end up in blue. And we also tried to end up in red. And there was almost nothing in red. And we weren't getting very many blue cards. So we ended up like going into like black and green because we, ended up seeing like Dark Confidant, and our curve was very low. And we saw like Oko and Uro, that kind of stuff. And we were thinking, oh yeah, we'll just get the pieces of power later. We'll just get the fetch lands and stuff later. And so, as I already alluded to, we just got zero fetch lands and the one, the one piece of power.
Wow, that sounds like a rough spot.
Oh yeah, I thought that like as soon as the draft was over, I was like, well, we could just save time and drop from the league now, or we could just get our best shot. And then yeah, so Crackshot, you had just asked whether Storm was dominant, I guess, and we played against two Storm decks in rounds 1 and 2, and they were both pretty, I don't know, underwhelming. Like, I think the first one had a playset of Narset, but it just didn't have like the win cons and the payoffs, like not enough wheels to really get there. Do you believe that the four color deck that I drafted with no fixing and almost no power trophied?
I'm really proud of you. What can I say?
I don't really know what happened. And frankly, I mean, I don't think I was supposed to like get a trophy. And again, I think I would have been very happy with a 2-1. Basically, the deck was just 2-mana interaction just over and over, and then some good answers and actually almost no threats. Like, there was like a Chandra. I guess you had Uro and Oko. And we had one copy of Hull Breacher in the deck as well. And that card is just basically, yeah, just says like...
In response to a Jaws 7, but not only response, but you actively cast a Jaws 7 with Hull Breacher in play. And it's just right. Too much, man.
Yeah. The Hull Breacher is a card that I've actually heard a lot of complaints about too. So like separately from this format as a whole, people are saying Hull Breacher is too good, which really is not what Vintage Cube is about. Vintage Cube is not a format where people say a card is too good, remove it for that reason. Like that doesn't happen.
No, because it works in all fronts. It works in all fronts. It's a 3 to flash or a 3, which is aggressively costed. It has an ability that allows you to play defensively. It has an ability that allows you to do offensive use of it. So it really does it all. It really does it all. If it even didn't make treasures, I think the card would be very good.
I agree. And for me, a lot of the time, it didn't matter that the treasure was made because, I mean, I think that might be specific to the Supreme format, but I already had so much like fast mana that it was like, you know, I guess these are helpful because I'm playing a four-color deck, but other than that...
What I've heard about Hull Breacher is putting it in the same tier as Sol Ring. There's the Power 9, and then there's a first tier of cards in Vintage Cube. Specifically in this format, definitely, but I think it's still going to apply in normal Vintage Cube.
I think in normal Vintage Cube, it's a higher pick than Force of Will. Force of Will only goes, like, it's only amazing and only in some decks, while I think Hull Breacher might be great in any blue deck.
Yeah, it's not at its best against, like, aggro, but even there, you know, Pouncing Cheetah or hold up counters. Yeah.
I will happily play one in my Storm deck and have a blocker.
It does not only interact with your opponent, like you can combo with it yourself. That's what you just said with the draw 7.
Yeah, same with like back too.
It plays in all fronts and I think it has proved to be a bit too much. At least in Supreme, I have done around 10 Supremes and I have one trophy. And it has exhausted me. I mean, I was really fighting because I said, man, I have to get a trophy somehow. And the Hull Breacher has been a huge part both for and against me so many times.
Yeah, it will feel very different in normal Vintage Cube. It will not come up as often.
I hope so. And also, and you have one in normal Vintage Cube. But yeah, I mean, I liked it as a rarity, the format. It's just the most busted things around. As a drawback, I'd say the card pool is reduced. Not all the cards in the Vintage Cube are playable. While in normal Vintage Cube, yeah, you can almost use all cards somewhere or another. But here you're only playing like a percentage of the cards that have opened. It's all variations of the same deck, really. And yeah, you can meta. And try to go like a Thousand Year Storm with a lot of burn. Or you can try to, I don't know, try a mono red. I have liked watching Caleb D doing the format because his approach is a bit different. He tries to, I mean, if the deck presents, I call it the deck, right? Because it's what we're talking about, like all the power, the small planeswalkers, Tinker, the massive things. But he tries, he knows, I like the guy a lot. He plays very well and he knows all the angles of the game. So he can adapt to a lot of situations and he plays very well. And Leovold, for example, is a card that has gone, Leovold was a house, right? In the last iteration of Vintage Cube. And now you have Hull Breacher, which really, you don't need, Leovold is three colors and Hull Breacher is two colorless and a blue.
Yeah.
Right, so it's just upgraded it.
Yeah, and Leovold never traps your opponent, right? You play it and it sits there and is annoying.
And you can't,
But it's not exactly.
You can't play the hold. You can't play the hold in response to a time spiral. No.
Yeah.
I have never seen a format where my opponents have killed themselves more, either by casting a huge Mind's Desire that ends with their library, or mana creeps, mostly out card drawing their decks. I mean, but honestly, in 10 drafts, I think I've had 3 or 4 opponents kill themselves. But it's always cool to have a fresh format because nobody knows what they're doing, right? And
that is true. But I feel like the Supreme draft formats, they get solved much quicker than real new formats.
Oh, well, certainly. And now people start to try to meta and do different things, so you're not always playing against the very same deck. So it's always cool. It's cool as a novelty, and it's a bit like Commander Legends. You're not there to win, you know, you're just there to have a fun time, I hope. I mean, at least I think that's the only healthy approach to it, because if you're really in it to win it, you're gonna have a rough time. I mean, that's applicable to Vintage Cube itself, but here more so. I mean, degenerate is the word, but degenerate power is fun.
My experience of this format, I mean, it was a lot like what you were saying, just about new formats in general. Like, I was prepared to hate this format. I wasn't going to play it at all. I was, you know, I listened to all the people complaining about the format and I believed they were right. I still believe most of what they were saying is accurate, because I had those like absolute floor level expectations. I really, really enjoyed myself going into a draft and not experiencing that.
I totally agree. Also, walking into a game and knowing that you can be dead before you can play a land. I mean, this format has exhausted me. I end my leagues and I'm exhausted when I play here because it's just overwhelming.
Okay, so now should we talk about Arena Cube?
I'm having fun at it, and it's at an interesting power level, I would say, because it does what many people expect of cubes, which is trying to be balanced, but also trying to be at the highest power level possible within the constraints. So it's just historic cards, and it has a lot of the most powerful cards on Arena, but some cards were also cut for power level purposes, or because people just are a bit fed up with them. So Uro, for example, is not there, and Oko is not there, and I think both Teferis are missing because it's not too planeswalker centric. And I think it just feels like a good format, and I like that it has a few 2-card combos that I've been trying to go after, but always just seem to get the one part of the combo. It's driving me crazy because I really want to have one time a combo, real combo deck in this format, but I can't seem to get it.
It does sound like a fun cube because most of the cards are modern. There's cards that don't see the light of day in other mainstream cubes.
And
new territory. And that's always fun to explore. I have to say, personally, I do not play modern and legacy cubes, you know, on MTGO. I don't know why exactly, but I don't. And I'm always in the alternative calendar.
I think those actually have a really narrow appeal just because I think most people who play in the alternative play calendar just prefer Vintage Cube. So I don't know. I think those environments are interesting, but they don't target a very wide range of players. But as for the Arena Cube, you're right, Jacob, I haven't tried it out, but I have listened to what a lot of people think. And it sounds like now that they're offering a best-of-3 format, that seems like a really important difference in people's enjoyment of the experience.
Having sideboarding, having best-of-3 made it much better.
I was talking to Jasper earlier, and he mentioned he's liking best-of-1.
Yes.
Because you do play against a broader variety of decks, right? Because you do play 7 games from what I hear, because I don't have Arena personally, so I can't. join you much in this discussion. But I always thought Best of One was kind of crappy too. But maybe for this it has its appeal.
It is nice that you see a lot of different decks. But what I dislike about it is it's still a relatively big format. And if you are in the learning phase and didn't look closely at the contents of the cube, it's really hard to play around cards. And I feel like Best of One is super punishing there because you can't adjust your game plan from game one onwards and really try to interact in a way that's meaningful. Once you really got a grasp on the format, I feel like Best of One also can work for me. While I'm still missing the sideboarding, I'm still like not a big fan of Best of One at all.
One thing that kind of ties this discussion into our discussion of Chaos earlier is that we've talked before about people being able to draft their own custom cubes on Arena, of course, with the limited card set that is available there. But I know now that some people are doing Chaos drafts of sorts on Arena too, which to me, like, I wouldn't be able to jump into that because I don't have the wild cards to just get everything on there. But it seems like a really cool way of doing things because the packs are already set up by set. Again, there isn't a wide variety of sets on there, but it does seem like a pretty cool way of, I won't say making Chaos evergreen because I don't think it quite is Chaos without, you know, most of the sets from Magic's history, but I think it's still a pretty cool thing that people are able to do.
It's more than 9 sets, so.
Right, yeah, definitely.
Right, Juan. Well, thank you so much for joining us on this episode.
I think we've covered a lot. I hope it was as enjoyable for you as it was for me. I had a blast.
Yeah,
it was very nice. And yeah, everybody who's interested in one of our cubes, I believe my super low power level cube will be ready after the holidays.
I'm excited to try that one. Honestly, that sounds really good.
Yeah, I'm really interested if people will enjoy it or if people will be fed up with reading weird cards.
Never.
Join our Discord and yeah, play with us. Come say hi. Yeah, and see you in the queues.
Bye bye.
Happy cubing.